Coming up this hour, gasoline prices are making sense while textbook prices are not. And Matt Thompson joins us live from LB Hall with women's basketball coach Pam Reuter. Sit back for this semester's last edition of Titan TV News.
Live from the Titan TV Center at the University of Wisconsin Oshkosh. BJ Lutz, Jeff LaVica, Lori Kovaleski with sports, and Patrick Moore with weather. This is Titan TV News.
If you're driving anywhere for the holidays, low gasoline prices may leave you with a little extra cash for gifts. Good afternoon and welcome to this special one-hour season semester finale of Titan TV News. I'm BJ Lutz.
And I'm Jeff LaVica. Gasoline prices continue to tumble. The latest AAA Motor Club survey shows the average price for unleaded regulars just over 98 cents a gallon. That's the first time gas prices have been below a dollar a gallon in nearly 10 years. Last month's average was $1.06 a gallon. Analysts credit the economic turmoil in Asia for the drop in gasoline prices. They say wholesale prices are down and some of the savings are being passed on to consumers.
With the recent upswing in student voting, a student here at UW-Oshkosh is preparing himself for a run at the Oshkosh City Council. Michael Eaton explains.
On April 6, 1999, the city of Oshkosh will elect four of its seven city council representatives. One of the people who has made it known that he will run is OSA Vice President Matt O'Malley. This will be Matt's second attempt for a seat on the council. So why did he decide to run again?
Well, I'm 2 years older now. I think people can take me more seriously now that I'm 21. And not only that, I've been much more involved in the community. I've been involved with philanthropies such as the Christine Ann Center, Adopt a Highway, the Boys and Girls Club. I'm a recent graduate of the Oshkosh Police Department Citizens Academy. I think that you can take someone seriously when they get involved in the community, and something that I've done the last 2 years.
In this, his second time around, Matt has made some changes in his campaign strategy that could assure him more votes in this next election.
I think I need to do more door-to-door. I did a little bit of it last time, but this time I'm more dedicated to it. I want to hear what the people have to say. That's really the underlying message of my campaign, is that what the people say is the most important thing to me.
What sort of issues will Matt be addressing during the campaign?
Well, first off, Main Street. I think that Main Street doesn't look as good as it should. I want to be able to sit down with the business owners and the Chamber of Commerce and have some discussion. You know, we keep talking about fixing Main Street, but nobody's sent anything to the business owners. You know, what do you think, business owner on Main Street? Another issue that's really important to me is the kind of community feeling that I think that we have here. And I think that we need to garner that feeling and start having town meetings again. And I'm in favor of the City Council sponsoring two town meetings a year.
We spoke with some students and found out their opinions on a student running for city council.
We need people to put forth effort towards the community and work with the school and community together.
I think it's a positive thing, but my only concern is his voice not being heard because of his age or his inexperience.
Even though the election is still 4 months away, Matt O'Malley has already begun working towards his bid for the Oshkosh City Council. And his chances of success hinge first and foremost upon the student vote and then upon the city at large. Michael Eaton, Titan TV News.
The semester is winding down and many seniors are gearing up for graduation. Mid-year commencement ceremonies will be held Saturday, December 18th at Kauf Sports Center. Chancellor John Kerrigan will confer graduate and undergraduate degrees in business administration, education and human services, letters in science, and nursing. Faculty speaker for commencement will be Michael Ford from the Reading faculty, and the student speaker is Brett Davis, who will receive a Bachelor of Arts degree in Business Administration. The ceremony starts at 9:30 and December 18th at Kauf. And campuses across the country are becoming more feminized. Debbie Nelson is in the newsroom with numbers from the United States Department of Education.
Thanks, BJ. Well, latest statistics show that the number of men on college campuses has declined every year from 1991 to 95, but rose slightly in 1996. That's the last year for which figures are available. In contrast to that, the number of women attending college has climbed every year. The Education Department predicts that by the year 2007, there will be over 9 million women attending college, but fewer than 7 million men. Education experts say they don't know why fewer men are choosing higher education, but some think that the booming economy is causing more men to enter the workforce directly. The experts warn that men who choose not to go to college or university may find their careers run into a dead end because of the lack of advanced education. Now back to you, Jeff.
With Christmas right around the corner, holiday shopping is in full effect. Titan TV News went to Media Play in Appleton to give us some holiday shopping tips.
This Christmas season, choosing a gift for someone shouldn't have to be a chore. One gift that's probably at the top of everybody's wish list is the gift of music.
Media Play is one of the many record stores in the area. I stopped by to see what's hot this season and spoke with the general manager, Mike Rowland, to find out what people are buying.
Now, what are some CDs that have been selling great this season?
I think the one that really sticks out is the new Garth Brooks release. He's got a new live album, which is featured with four different covers, and that's huge for collectors. A lot of great gifts there. And then the other interesting thing, even though it's been out on the market for several months, is the Titanic soundtrack. The buzz with the movie has, especially with the sell-through video release, has created a lot of additional interest in the soundtrack, so that's been huge too.
What's so unusual about this Christmas is there was a higher amount of new releases by superstar acts, which creates more of a demand.
Basically, what's really unique about this holiday season is we've got a lot of superstar artists that have brand new releases. You have Garth Brooks, Madonna, Metallica, Shania Twain. These are all artists that haven't had new releases of new music in the past 2 years. So this is very unique that all the releases came at once, and it's going to make a great record fourth quarter for us and for the industry.
Rock bands have plenty of new music to choose from this season, including Bruce Springsteen's new box set, Tracks.
Other rock hits include Offspring, U2, Pearl Jam, The Goo Goo Dolls, and Metallica, whose new album entitled Garage Incorporated features early recordings with a few new tracks, including their cover of the Bob Seger classic, Turn the Page. Lovers can look forward to the Greatest Hits package by Mariah Carey and long-anticipated albums by Seal and Alanis Morissette.
Fans of R&B and rap also have a lot to look forward to this Christmas season, such as Jermaine Dupri and Maxwell's latest, Embraya.
Other R&B hits include Brandy and Monica, R. Kelly, and Lauryn Hill. Some of the new rap releases include a Greatest Hits package from Tupac, solo albums from the Wu-Tang Clan members Method Man and RZA, and the latest from Jay-Z, which features the hit single, Can I Get A? Another album that has generated a lot of interest is the soundtrack to the popular television show South Park. It features the character Cartman doing his rendition of the Styx classic, Come Sail Away, as well as new songs from Rancid, Elton John, and Perry Farrell. We leave you now with Master P and Chef with their track, Kenny's Dead. Happy holidays. Jamie Buxman, Titan TV News.
And Lori Kovaleski's in now with our first look at sports of the day.
That's right. The Lady Titans basketball team is off to a great start this season. Now live from LB Hall is sports director Matt Thompson.
That's right, Lori. The Oshkosh Lady Titans are 7-0 entering this weekend's game against Superior. The Oshkosh Lady Titans, Pam Reuter and coach, entering this weekend's game against the Superior team that over the last 18 years, you guys are 30-1, but as we were talking just a few minutes ago, you remember that one loss, but you've got to beat this team this weekend.
Each game that we face, we have to look at it as teams are going to get up to beat the defending conference champion, and Superior is a different team this year than they've been in the last few even, but they're talented. They've got a conference win against La Crosse already this season, and we have to be well prepared when we go up there.
Hi, Coach. Let's go back to the offseason. There was a job opening in Green Bay, and from some of the local media, we found out that you were called about that job. What went on there?
Yes, there's an opening in Green Bay, but not something that I would be interested in. I did receive a call actually from Michigan Tech after Kevin did receive the job in Green Bay, but again, not something that I would want to pursue.
All right, entering this season, your ladies were obviously preseason number one. How did that affect the mindset of your team entering your first basketball game against Viterbo College in La Crosse?
Definitely, it's an honor to get that preseason billing as high as number one in some of those polls, but basically it doesn't mean a heck of a lot. Where you are at the beginning of the season does not matter. It's where you are at the end of the season, and we are experienced enough to know what it takes in the process of getting there is what's important, rather than saying we're number one. I mean, that's not going to hold too much as far as where we want to be at the end of the season. That's what matters.
All right, you lost one senior, Holly Spoo, obviously a big loss because she was the WIAC Player of the Year, but you've got two more seniors now that have stepped up, Rachel Lachecki and Kelly Warnke. Talk about the importance of them as a leadership role on this basketball team.
To be successful, you have to have that leadership, and Rachel and Kelly are doing a nice job, but the nice thing about our team this year is the tremendous balance that we have. Five different people scoring double figures in our, or averaging double figures in our first seven games. That makes us very, very tough to defend. So we're in good position, but we always do have those two down low that we can depend on as when needed.
All right, you're in the midst of a six-game road trip, an odd quirk in scheduling at this time of year. How is your team approaching that?
One game at a time is our focus. We went down to Whitewater on Wednesday, heading up to Superior, and then a few non-conference games over the holiday break. But it's also a test of what this team is all about. We obviously enjoy playing here at Albee Hall on our home court, but you have to be able to play well on the road as well. And so we'll accept those challenges and hopefully prepare for each of our opponents and be ready to face them wherever.
All right, thanks, Coach. That's head coach Pam Reuter of the Oshkosh Lady Titans. 56-6 is her record as head coach, Lori. That is impressive.
Thanks, Matt. The UW-Oshkosh men's basketball team isn't looking quite as stellar as the ladies so far this season, but that's nothing new for them. Last year, the Titans started out 1-2 in the WIAC, but regrouped and were invited to the NCAA Division III tournament. Wednesday night at Culp Sports Center, the men took a beating from the undefeated UW-Whitewater Warhawks. Poor shooting and rebounding by the Titans pushed Whitewater to a 90-73 victory. The Titans will have a chance to turn around their season when UW-Superior comes to town Saturday afternoon. Unexpected events happen every day, but during the UW-Oshkosh Swimming and Diving Invitational, it got a little out of hand. During a race Friday afternoon, fire alarms went off and sent competitors and spectators outside. Races were resumed later in the evening. After all the commotion ended, the men placed fourth in the meet, scoring 272 points, while the women finished third. The women's team earned the Titans' only championship in the Invitational as Emily Allen won the 100-meter butterfly. The Titans will host Central College tonight in Albee Hall. The UW-Oshkosh wrestling team hasn't started out exactly as planned. After being undefeated in the preseason, they fell to Platteville in their first WIAC meet. The nationally ranked Pioneers won seven of the last eight matches and received a forfeit to beat the Titans 27-14. The team travels to River Grove on Saturday to battle it out with Triton College. And although the UW-Oshkosh baseball team is in the offseason, the awards just keep rolling in. The most recent award goes to head coach Tom Lechner. Lechner was named the American Baseball Coaches Association Midwest Regional Coach of the Year. Lechner will be presented the award on January 4th in Atlanta. Last season, Lechner was the WIAC Coach of the Year after leading the Oshkosh to a 36-2 regular season record. Also receiving honors this week was UW-Oshkosh football player John May. May has been selected to play in the 51st annual Aztec Bowl, an all-star game featuring the top 38 seniors in NCAA Division III play. The team will play the Mexican all-star team in Monterrey, Mexico on December 13th. That's our first look of sports. I'll be back with more, including how to prepare for the ski season, and an interview with a UW Oshkosh professor who does more than just teach.
All right, Lori, thanks a lot. We'll check back with you later. As we go to break, here's a look at some upcoming Titan athletics. We'll be right back.
The Oshkosh Common Council will be considering a proposal that could affect
a large area of landlords and homeowners. The proposal involves eliminating potential sources of lead poisoning in dwellings. For children, the leading cause of lead poisoning is lead-based paint. Symptoms of lead poisoning include fatigue, crankiness, and stomach aches. But usually there are not signs, and a blood test is the only sure way to tell.
Oshkosh will soon have its name plastered on peas, corn, carrots, and other vegetables. A Berlin area company has decided to cash in on the city's name in marketing its food items. Beginning December 20th, Green Giant will face some competition as Oshkosh brand veggies hit the supermarket. Industry experts say it's tough to break into the frozen food market, but Oshkosh Food Incorporated is counting on the city's name recognition provided by Oshkosh Bagosh and the EAA.
Well, textbook buyback is a frustrating time for many UWO students. Debbie Nelson investigates the pros and cons of the sellback process.
It's that time of the year again when students sell back their used textbooks for some needed holiday cash. But unfortunately for many, the return isn't even enough to stuff a stocking.
I paid over $300 and I didn't get anything back. $300 and I have $5 back. And one book is no good. And we didn't even use it in the class, so I'm upset.
Well, I paid about over $300 for my textbooks, and the one book that I did that I was able to sell back, my social problems book, I only got $26.75, and I paid about $50 for it. Mm-hmm. My other book, my sociology book, I couldn't sell back, and that was about a $60 book because it's an old edition, and now I'm kind of stuck with it.
With rising costs and diminishing return rates, students are asking why doesn't UW Oshkosh have a rental system similar to UW system schools like Stevens Point, La Crosse, Stout, Eau Claire, Whitewater, Platteville, River Falls, and Superior. Advanced Titan publications from 1969 record the first formal studies surveying support of a purchase system. In 1966, the faculty unanimously voted in favor of the change, while a student poll revealed a 61% vote for retention of the rental plan, but with an option to buy. But 3 years later, the voting populace had a change of heart. 56% of students that voted were in favor of a purchasing system. And this vote was enough to prompt President Giles and the Student Faculty Administration to go ahead and implement the new system in the summer of 1970. At that time, a series of policies and practices were outlined which stressed that UWO must be consistent and strive to meet. Among these guidelines is Objective B, which states the system should provide textbooks to students at a reasonable cost.
Almost 30 years later, the university bookstore's so-called reasonable costs are cleaning out students' wallets and causing them to raise a curious eyebrow.
Our prices are based on breaking even and building that cash reserve, and that determines whether we would increase or decrease the margin on textbooks.
So who is the culprit, and why are textbooks so expensive?
The difficulty that I'm facing now is a lot of the package sets. And it's hard to decide how much of that the professor really meant to require. In this particular package, the professor wasn't satisfied with the artwork in the book, so he got the company to agree to do a supplement. In some cases, I can't compete with the new book package. But now the problem is, I can't purchase any of these used, really, because they're all consumable. Mm-hmm. There's a wholesale price on the book only, and that's $15.
I think the publishing companies, they would tell us that their educational reasons are the only reason that they put out course packs. I think, in truth, another reason is that they want to reduce the used book market as much as possible, and course packs are one real way of doing that.
Ultimately, Joe Blom and his staff understand the concerns of rising costs for students. Bookstore markups have been lowered from 30% to 20% in the past 10 years, but Blom wants students to know that the purchase system is the best program for their educational needs.
The purchase system is best for students because it allows the flexibility to adapt to new books that are out there, to use new materials from semester to semester and not be locked in for a long period of time.
So students pay for the colored pictures, extensive research costs, and multimedia extras. But the bottom line is, do students use the resources they are required to buy?
It was right before tests to review from the notes that I had gotten, and very seldom did I actually use it. It was more of a reference.
I relied more on the textbooks, but I didn't use them.
Textbook costs will continue to rise, and the price students are paid for used books will continue to fall. UW-Oshkosh students just have to live with the hefty cost of their education. Debbie Nelson, Titan TV News.
University bookstore director Joe Blom suggests that OSA President Maggie Brown encourage students to write their state legislators requesting textbook sale tax exemptions. Missouri and New York have already passed such laws. UW-Oshkosh students will finally have their long-awaited Burger King. On January 18th, the fast food restaurant will begin serving its Whoppers, fries, onion rings, and other popular fast food items. It will be the only restaurant open in Reeve Memorial Union on Martin Luther King Day. Its hours of operation on that legal holiday are 10 to 6 p.m.
The son of a Jefferson County couple missing since the 4th of July has refused Sheriff's Department request to take a lie detector test. Investigator Robert Henze says they offered Derek Anderson several options, but he declined to be tested. Anderson's parents, Alan and Donna Kernack, and his brother Thomas disappeared while on their way to their cottage in Washera County. Anderson has been a suspect in the case, and he told a Madison newspaper last month that he would take a polygraph test to clear his name. His attorney has since advised him against that. Well, as you know, starting next week is finals week, and as we go to break, if you need a place to study, go check out Polk Library. We'll be right back. Starting next fall, UW-Oshkosh students will have another 16-digit number to remember when the university begins issuing new Titan cards. And as Sunny Wong explains, social security numbers can no longer be used on public documents like identification cards.
In the spring semester, the Titan Card office will be busy reissuing new student IDs for UW-Oshkosh students. Associate Director of Reeve Union, Mitch Kilcrease, says there will be a couple of reasons for a change.
The first thing is the university is going through a change in our student informational system. We currently have a system that keeps a track of all the students, their information, their numbers, and their enrollment status and all that. It's called Legacy, it's a student informational system, SIS. And we're changing that over to PeopleSoft with a new system that's going to force us to change some things. That's one thing. Number two is there was a law passed last year called AB 227, a Wisconsin state statute that requires us to stop using the Social Security card as a primary identifier effective January 2000.
When the new ID is issued, Kilcrease hopes to have two new conveniences for the Titan card.
What we're looking at right now is some opportunities to advance the card as far as some services. One of them is developing a banking relationship where your card could be used with an ATM relationship. Other ones are phone card relationships. Other things that we're looking at a little bit further down the line, which won't impact the card right now, but some relationships, off-campus spending, being able to use your card off campuses and facilities. So those are all things that we're looking at. The banking and the phone card are probably the two most realistic things that could potentially happen within the next year or so.
Since Social Security numbers can no longer be printed on public documents, each student will receive an individual 16-digit ID number.
Your ID now will be a 16-digit ISO number. Part of that is the first six digits of the card are numbers that are the same for everybody on campus. It identifies the university specifically. The next seven are that IMPLET number, those seven-digit IMPLET number. The next two are some subcode identification. And the last one is what's called a check digit. And it's a mathematical equation that allows us to make sure that number is the right number.
Because the Titan Card Office already has the student images on computer file, new photos won't have to be taken in the recarding process.
The current Titan Card system stores all of your images and information, and what we're going to do is write a software application that will allow us to take those images and that information and import it into the new system and produce cards, so we won't have to physically have you come in to take another photo, which is very time consuming.
The recording process will take place in spring and summer, and the new Titan Card will be issued in the fall semester 1999. Sunny Wong, Titan TV News.
And when the new Titan Card is issued, it will have a whole new design. Well, soon Badger season ticket holders will find out if everything is coming up roses.
That's right, they're in a
computerized lottery drawing. Lucky fans will get tickets to the Rose Bowl. Assistant Ticket Director Canyon West says they've taken five times as many orders as they have tickets available. The UW got 25,000 tickets and is hoping to round up a few more. In the meantime, many area travel agencies have sold out of their Rose Bowl packages. Concord Travel owner Michael Lee says the demand is just as strong, if not stronger, than it was 5 years ago when the Badgers went to Pasadena. Lori Kovaleski has more on the Rose Bowl later in sports.
There appears to be a moose on the loose in Langlade County. Local officials from the Department of Natural Resources say a small bull moose has been spotted in several communities. The DNR's Carl McWilliam says a moose appears in Langlade County just once every 3 or 4 years. He says they'll keep an eye on the animal and hope it makes its way back up north without injury.
And Greenhagen Residence Hall staff and residents are teaming up with the Christine Ann Center to provide some holiday cheer for some local children. Saturday's event will feature photos with Santa Claus, cookie and ornament decorating, food, games, gifts, and storytelling. UW Oshkosh Communications Professor and professional storyteller Carol Robinson will provide interactive tales of medieval holiday lore.
We hope you're enjoying this hour-long edition of Titan TV News. Sit back. We've got another half an hour of news, weather, and sports coming up. And as we leave you, here's us a look at some upcoming holiday events. We'll be right back. With a second look at the sports world, here's Lori.
Thanks, BJ. Although snow has been scarce so far in Wisconsin this year, many people hope that will soon change. Michelle Petrosky takes a look at what you can do to get ready for the ski season.
It's Christmas time, even though there's no snow on the ground, but we're here at Herger's Sporting Goods Center talking to Mark Spanbauer about tips on ski equipment.
Typically what we do when someone comes in is we try and get a profile of the person as far as height, weight, age, and ability level. Whether the lady skis or men skis, you have the option of buying a basic beginner ski, an intermediate ski, an advanced ski. Once you get to the advanced, then you're going to run into different little categories, whether it's more of a cruising, big open turn ski, or more of a steeper hill type, shorter, quicker turn type ski.
For anyone interested in skiing, there are two different styles of boots to suit your needs.
If you're looking for performance, you're probably going to do a front entry boot. If you're looking for comfort and warmth, you're probably going to do a rear entry boot.
To connect your boots to the skis are bindings, which keep your feet on the skis or lets them go if you fall.
Ski bindings are the mechanical part of the ski combination that holds your boot onto the ski. What people don't realize is that the binding has to be smart enough to keep you on the ski when you're in control, but let you off before you get hurt. Generally, we'll do a ski and a binding in a package and then discount the package and then have the boots as an option at a discounted price also. It's difficult to put a boot into a package because every size this boot's made in may never fit you.
Hopefully the snow will come around and we can get into action with downhill skiing. Michelle Petrosky, Titan TV Sports.
For anyone interested in downhill skiing in the Oshkosh area, the closest hill is Nordic Mountain in Mount Morris. Okay, math whizzes, how many miles per hour are you going if you run 100 kilometers in 7 hours 26 minutes? You could ask UW Oshkosh math professor Stephen Sidlick. He recently competed in the 100-kilometer World Challenge race in Nakamura, Japan, and was the top U.S. finisher, coming in 16th. I had a chance earlier this week to sit down and talk with him about his experiences. The time in Japan wasn't your best time, but you felt it was your best performance due to race conditions. What sort of things adversely affected the race?
The course was very hilly. Mm-hmm. It was most of the 100K world championship races have been fairly flat and very fast, and this one you had to go up basically a mountain at between 6 and 10 miles, 6 and 12 miles.
Japan was your third World Challenge event. Which was your favorite?
The first one I did was in 1995 in the Netherlands, and that one I really liked. I didn't run particularly well there, but I love the country.
Like when you go into these international events, what's the competition like?
It's tough competition. The Russians are extremely strong. They in the Japan race they had the top four spots, and their fourth place finisher was 20 minutes ahead of the next finisher.
So what are your plans for future races?
The next World Challenge is in France in May. Mm-hmm. And they go through a selection process again. They don't have time to do a national championship. So I would feel reasonably good about my chances of being selected, although you can never be too sure.
Although he is likely to be picked to the team for next year's challenge, Sidlick says he will probably not attend, as he and his wife are expecting a baby in spring. On New Year's Day, the Badgers will be in Pasadena, California to take on the UCLA Bruins in the Rose Bowl. Titan TV's Jeff Grice took to the streets to find out what people predict.
Well, as most of you already know, the Badgers have won another trip to the Rose Bowl by being co-champions of the Big Ten. Let's see what people have to say. Can you predict a score on the Rose Bowl game?
Sure, Badgers 32-28.
Yes, I would say Badgers 21, UCLA 17.
I would have to say, as much of a Badger fan as I am, I don't think they're going to win. I think they're going to lose by 10, to be honest with you. I mean, I hope they do win, but I think they're going to lose probably by 10, like probably 35-25 around there.
I lived in California, so probably UCLA about 20-23, and then maybe Badgers probably get about 15.
Can you predict the score on the Badgers in the Rose Bowl?
Badgers.
Give me a score on that.
29-13.
Badgers?
Yeah.
All right, thank you very much.
Need the soda.
From what I gathered, it looks like we're just going to have to wait until January 1st to see the outcome of the Rose Bowl. As for me, I'm going to stick with my home team. My prediction, Wisconsin 30, UCLA 27. Reporting for Titan TV Sports, I'm Jeff Grex.
UCLA coach Bob Toledo is worried about defense. Toledo told Rose Bowl reporters in L.A. yesterday that his Bruins didn't play well defensively all season long. They gave up 689 yards in last Saturday's 49-45 loss to Miami, a loss that knocked them out of a national title game. As you may have seen, Titan TV covers many Titan athletic events. You can see men's and women's basketball here on Channel 12. If you are unable to get to a television, you can also catch many of the games on WRST.
We've got a lot of basketball coming up on 90.3 WRST, starting with this Saturday's ball game against Superior. That's going to be a men's basketball game at the Kulf Sports Center. That game starts at 3 o'clock. Our pregame is 2:45. We're going to follow the men on Tuesday night as well. They're going to take on Cornell University. That's a 7 o'clock ball game. And then we're going to do some damage. We're going to go to Las Vegas, folks. The men are taking on two teams in Las Vegas in the Next Level Desert Classic. That's right, Las Vegas. Cliff Johnson's going to be there calling that action on Monday the 21st and Tuesday the 22nd. The following week, the women are going to be in South Dakota, and we're going to follow them, too. We're going to take a bus out there and do those games on a Monday and a Tuesday as well, the 29th and 30th. And then, of course, January 2nd, the women are playing in Madison against Edgewood College. I'll be doing that ball game at 1:30 on that Saturday afternoon. So those are some of the upcoming WRST ball games. Of course, this year we've got the WIAC tournament, February 20th through the 27th. That's going to be a lot of basketball action. Both the men's and women's teams are going to be playing in there. We don't know, of course, where they're going to be playing or what times yet, but stay tuned listening to 90.3 WRST. Now back to you, Laurie.
Thanks, Matt. Well, that's it for sports this week. We'll be right back after the break with more news and weather.
Well, the battle over lowering the drinking age on college campuses does not seem to be any less controversial this year. As Tom Picard reports, the issue is unlikely to be resolved anytime soon.
Every year, the debate about the drinking age raises questions about whether or not the drinking age should be lowered. While many underage students at universities do admit to drinking alcohol, some of them say that it is their right as an adult.
I think the drinking age should definitely be lowered, and I think one of the most embarrassing things is when people turn 21 and they don't promote it anymore, and it's like, because they remember what it's like to be 21. The biggest reason that the drinking age doesn't get changed is because people don't support it once they turn 21. 19 is a more respectable age just because you don't want to get it mixed up in high school. And but the main reason is that people got to keep the support alive once they turn 21.
I think the drinking age should definitely be lowered. It's actually the whole thing's beyond me why it's at 21. People are drinking anyway at 18, 19. And what are they doing? They're driving. They're getting all. They're going behind the backs of the people and causing more trouble than if they are of age going to bars.
Owner of Molly Maguire's, Tom Tager, says drinking will always be a part of college life, but he still has to make sure those who are underage don't get in.
Well, from a business standpoint of view, obviously, we'd like to see it lowered. I mean, 19, I think, is a realistic drinking age because that keeps it out of the high school and pretty much just gets it into the college. And, you know, I think it's a part of going to college. While you're in college, it's kind of your time to have fun and that type of thing. But, you know, as it stands right now, it's 21, and that's what we have to enforce. We always keep a close eye on it. There's always, I mean, people are always trying to get in. Some nights are worse than others. Weekends are always a big night that they try to get into. But, I mean, it's just an ongoing situation that we always have to deal with.
Winnebago County Crime Prevention Officer Steve Herman says he sees no problems if the drinking age was lowered to 18.
If they repealed it and went back to 18, I don't think we'd have any more problems than we have now, realistically. We might have less. You know, I think some of our problems that we have now with the underage drinking is because most people feel that 21 is too old.
But Herman also says it's his duty to uphold the current drinking laws.
I was 21, mm-hmm. And the sheriff's office stand is that if officers come across someone who is underage who has been consuming alcohol, we'll take appropriate action. I'm paid to do a job, mm-hmm. And our other officers are paid to do a job. And whether we like the law or we don't like the law, we still have to enforce it. Whether we agree or disagree, we can't really put that into play.
While many college students voice their opinion against the current drinking age, the debate continues to brew. Tom Picard, Titan TV News.
Patrick Moore is on his way into the studio to tell us about the crazy weather outside, but first, here we take a look at what some students and staff are asking from that jolly fellow we call Santa.
My second semester tuition paid for, so if Santa could bring me that would be very much appreciated.
I play guitar, and I want a wah-wah pedal so I can be like, wow.
One day of snow so I can go snowmobiling, and then that's all.
A good home-cooked meal. What do you want Santa to bring you for Christmas?
Snowmobile.
What kind?
Arctic.
I would like Santa not to bring me, but to bring everybody a very happy, warm, and enjoyable, and safe Christmas season.
The temperatures are remaining above normal, and Patrick Moore joins us now to let us know if we're going to see any snow. Patrick?
You know, you guys just won't stop bugging me. Everybody wants to know, when is it going to snow? When is it going to be winter? Well, 2 weeks until Christmas, and I'm wondering if Bing Crosby's going to come back and start singing I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas, because I'm not seeing it as of right now. Temperature is still well above normal. Let's take a look at conditions outside in Oshkosh. 43 degrees, well above the normal. We'll take a look at that in just a second. Winds are out of the southwest, which is giving us a little bit cooler of a temperature, but still is very nice outside. Humidity is at 72%, and the pressure is steady at 30.28 inches. Now to our almanac. There you go. We are 16 degrees above the average temperature. For 45 should be our high today. 28 for a low tonight, and we'll keep those clear skies around. Normal low is at 14, so you see we're very balmy yet here. Already to the middle of December. Record high was 57, record low of minus 17. Temperatures around the United States, you can see it's
pretty much warm in the Midwest, 30 degrees in Chicago, and it gets a little bit cooler as you head down to St. Louis, Missouri, but that's because they've kind of got a low front which is pushing its way. Look out to the west, and it's 48 degrees in Los Angeles and 75 degrees, the warm spot in Miami, Florida. Let's take a look now at the weather pattern and how things are looking up. Low temperatures, that's what we start with first. 20s all the way from the Dakotas, pushing its way all the way out to the east in New England. Then the 30s kind of settle the way into the south, and it progressively gets warmer. High temperatures around the United States are a little bit different, and there, that's what I thought would happen. Our map is gone. It's like a sandstorm across the United States, but don't worry. We're just having some trouble with the computer with the long hour show there. Now they're kind of, there they are, the high pressure. See, you just keep clicking it, and it works. Yeah, the CG is having a little bit of trouble, so we'll just skip right through that. Here's where that low pressure system is that I was saying giving a little bit cooler temperatures in Missouri. That'll be pushing its way. We'll get this high pressure system to come down, give us sun and a couple of clouds throughout the week as I advance that. Please push your way that way. Thank you, Mr. Computer. There's your sun. It'll stay here for probably the next 4 or 5 days, not giving us any of this stuff that everybody wants to see, of course, the snow. But we'll keep an eye on this weather pattern, which could give us some snow midweek next week. I know everybody's crossing their fingers. I've never really asked for snow, but everybody wants to see it. Hey, it is Christmas, and this is Wisconsin. Anyways, back to our satellite. Let's take a look, and we've got a sandstorm again. But don't worry. It's just the computer. Oh, there it is. It's kind of flipping its way through. Let's get right past that. Anyways, there's no clouds, nothing at the moment. We actually have nice, nice weather. Let's just go right to the afternoon forecast. Sunny skies, 45 degrees, and I've never had to improv like this, ladies and gentlemen. Afternoon forecast, we'll stay a decent day outside. Tonight it'll cool off. It'll remain clear outside, 28 degrees for a high, 5-day outlook. Now, what we were saying is pretty much what you see is what you get, and that's what we've had for today in the next 4 days. It's just going to be partly cloudy on Saturday, Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday, but those temperatures will stay the same, guys. It's going to remain warm, but let's keep our fingers crossed for Wednesday and Thursday as we maybe see a chance of snow actually coming out, but Mother Nature was not nice to our computer today, was it?
No. Wasn't that fun? I'm going to mention again how much I want to ski, so.
You have to do that. Yes.
We'll be right back with a look out at the people behind the scenes. Stay with us.
Welcome back. Well, every week the viewer gets to see BJ and I and the other anchors and reporters on camera. Well, we took a look behind the scenes with some still photography of the crew and cast of Titan TV News. Final check with weather with Patrick Moore. Patrick? Now let's take a look at that afternoon forecast again. It's going to be a decent day. We've had some nice Fridays. Should be about high of about 46 degrees. Tonight it'll cool off a little bit. Remain clear skies, 28 degrees. And as for the 5-day outlook, it'll remain pretty much the same. Clouds will stick around, but it's going to be a beautiful weekend. Good chance to get out and have a good time. Christmas shopping, of course. We know Lori will be hitting the malls and everything else this week, I'm sure.
Warm temperatures bring out the shoppers, isn't that right? Well, it's been a fun semester bringing you the newscast every Friday. I'm BJ Lutz for Jeff Levicka, Patrick Moore, Lori Kovaleski, and all of us here at Titan TV News. Happy holidays and good luck on your finals.